Under this bill, Charlie Sheen has immediate physical custody half of the time of his children, and that mother must come in, must get a court date, get on the calendar, and get before the judge to bring evidence that would convince the court that he should not have those children half the time.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Statehouse program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Education funding, shared parenting, and teen driving were all issues that lawmakers voted on in Pierre today. Hello and welcome to State House. I'm Stephanie Rissler. Today marked the 34th day of this year's legislative session, and with only 4 days left, that left many lawmakers scrambling to push their bills through the chambers. We'll begin in the full Senate as Senator Dan Lederman asked the body to pass his measure, which seeks to provide extra protection for members of the military that may be facing eviction. Here are the details on House Bill 1219.
House Bill 1219 would allow for our active duty military to have one extra month to, if they were in the process of being evicted, they would give them one extra month as opposed to what is in current statute right now, which would they would have only 30 days. It also extends this right to the immediate family being a spouse or a child. So this is just a common sense approach to help our active duty military.
We heard this in Judiciary, and it's a very good bill. It does have safeguards in it so that if the tenant were to have bad conduct that would warrant keeping to the 30-day period, that's accepted from the bill. But as you all know, in active military service in Afghanistan and in Iraq, many times the pay can get messed up. And this way, when these soldiers are moving around from one permanent change of station or temporary duty, they're going to be able to have another 30 days to let that pay catch up so that they can meet their obligations to the landlord back in South Dakota. It's a great bill, a recognition of what our soldiers are doing for us in fighting terror across the seas.
House Bill 1219 received enough votes to pass out of the Senate. The final outcome was 33-2. It now goes to the governor. Senator Todd Schleckaway then introduced House Bill 1221, a measure that will create a task force on teen driving safety.
Well, I'm excited today to stand before you and propose legislation that would establish a legislative task force on teen driving safety. I believe we have a great opportunity in front of us today, ladies and gentlemen, to establish this task force. This legislature, this institution, has precedence for doing this. We have in the past established task forces on children's mental health issues. We've established task forces on divorce. So this is falling along the same lines. Now, you may ask, why am I standing here talking about a task force on teen driving safety? Simply put, ladies and gentlemen, the statistics are alarming. If you look at some of those statistics, what it'll tell you is teen deaths from car crashes in South Dakota make it by far the leading cause of death for this age group. Each year in South Dakota, the tragedy of young drivers being injured or killed in car wrecks repeats itself over and over. In 2009, state records show drivers younger than 25 represented about a third of the injuries or fatalities, despite representing only 16% of the driving population at large. In addition, a current U.S. News and World Report recently compiled a ranking of states where teen drivers are safest. South Dakota, ladies and gentlemen, ranked 51st in that study. And that study was comprised of 11 variables from teens on the road, accidents, our safety laws, road quality, and distance traveled. What would the task force study? We would be studying data on teen driving, citations, crashes, deaths, and injuries, current statutes on our books involving teen driving, the driver's ed available and the training for driver's ed instructors, national best practices. So those are the type of things we would be delving into if we approve this today. Now, I just want to point out before I close, Section 2 of the bill outlines the composition of this task force, who would be on the task force. You can read it in Section 2 of the bill. I want to emphasize this is contingent on securing grant funds. This involves absolutely zero general fund monies. It's all contingent on grant money that will be rewarded likely next October. The state and the outside entities who are interested in this are in communications with the National Highway Traffic and Safety Administration Board. They're the most likely source for these outside grant monies, as well as some private insurance companies as well.
The measure passes with a 32-2 vote. It also will go to the governor for his consideration. House Bill 1255, known as the Shared Parenting Bill, was also debated on the Senate floor today. Senator Dan Lederman explained the bill.
I'm here to ask you for your support of House Bill 1255, more commonly known as the Shared Parenting Bill. House Bill 1255 is needed because our current child custody system is unfortunately broken. The current system incentivizes conflict because of the winner-take-all nature of the custodial versus non-custodial parenting model. South Dakota is currently a one-size-fits-all system for most custody cases, which results in the court system awarding custody to one parent over the other as a general practice. This system is clearly unfair to the children of divorce. It marginalizes the one parent and reduces the unique role each parent plays in child rearing. Our state is one of only 13 states that has still maintains a non-custodial custodial child custody system. Times have changed, and it's time to reform this now. House Bill 1255 will help accomplish this goal. House Bill 1255 begins and ends with fairness. The bill helps ensure both parents are viewed equally in the eyes of the court when a divorce proceeding begins by starting with the rebuttable presumption of joint physical custody. This gives children a chance to have both parents, if they're fit, to continue to be active in the child's life after divorce. The bill is child-centered because it requires the judge to look at the best interest of the children if he or she overrides the presumption. House Bill 1255 would increase the amount of discretion that our judges currently have. Under our existing laws, judges are unable to award 50-50 joint physical custody to otherwise fit parents. This bill allows the judge full discretion to keep unfit parents from having child custody. The bill also specifically requires the judge determine custody based on what is in the best interest of the child. House Bill 1255 also requires a judge to render a written opinion upon request, explaining to the parties the rationale for his or her decision if he delineates from a joint physical custody. HB 1255 requires an evidentiary hearing that gives both parties the opportunity to fully make their case in a court of law and ensure the judge has all the facts before a decision is rendered. This bill also allows the judge discretion to keep children out of the hands of abusers. Codified law section 25.445 already requires judges to take abuse into account during a custody proceeding. We intentionally designed the bill so the judge can overcome the presumption when it is in the best interest of the child. This very language is written into the bill that requires the judge to look at the best interest of the child. The general practice in other states is that overcoming a presumption of joint physical custody is determined by what is in the best interest of the child, and HB 1255 incorporates this idea. Don't be confused. The judge can rule that awarding the kids to one parent, if it is in the best interest of the child, this is consistent with line 10 of the bill. It is time to bring South Dakota in line with over 37 other states which have implemented some form of shared parenting for the benefit of our children.
1255RD amends page 2, line 8 of the of 1255 to remove the June 1st, 2008 and make the effective date of this act like any other bill. And my reason for that, Mr. President, members of the body, is that I've heard some concerns that that this bill's designed to benefit a person or a group of people that have already went through a very difficult situation and a very emotional time in their life for them and their children. And for the good or the bad, those are done. And they've had their custody cases heard and acted on. I'd like to see the body adopt the amendment for House Bill 1255 so that this is going forward, and the way that we should do laws in South Dakota is looking forward. So I'd appreciate your support of 1255RD.
One of the things that deeply disturbs me about this movement toward shared parenting that has been around for quite a while, this is really not a new or novel idea, is that it treats children as property to be equally divided between parents who cannot agree on the best interests of their child. There's a legal doctrine known as parens patriae, in which the court or the state has a compelling interest in the child when parents cannot or will not exercise or determine what's in their own child's best interests. It's a very old, established doctrine that assures us in society that someone looks out for the best interests of vulnerable or dependent persons, such as children are. Such is the case when parents resort to the courts for custody determinations. This subset of parents who cannot or will not agree as to what living arrangement will best suit the child after the breakup of the marriage, or for those never married, must submit to the court's decision-making. However, House Bill 1255 limits the court's discretion by creating a statutory fiction that supersedes the best interests of the child, with the notion from the get-go that in each and every case, instead, no other factors are relevant to the custody determination than the 50-50 time split. Look at Section 1, lines 8 through 11 of the bill, if you would, please. It establishes the rebuttable presumption that in each and every case, parents are to have joint physical custody of their children. As you go on to read in line 8, the burden of overcoming the presumption rests on the parent challenging the presumption. This means, because words mean something, that the court cannot, of its own motion, override this rebuttable presumption when the case is before the court. Instead, the court must wait until a parent challenges this presumption and presents evidence to the court before the court can take into consideration all of those other relevant factors about the child's life that amount to the best interests of the child. As you see, line 9, the presumption may be overcome by demonstrating that joint physical custody would not be in the best interests of the children, or by one parent waiving the presumption. This does not give the court the authority to override the presumption, because the next line tells you how the presumption must be overcome. The party challenging the presumption must overcome the presumption by the greater convincing force of the evidence. That is why House Bill 1255 limits the discretion of the court. In the beginning, the court can do nothing but hold to this presumption in the law. That's what presumptions in the law do. They take away the court's discretion. And in this case, the court cannot simply override what is in the court's mind the best interests of the child. Instead, the court has to wait until a moving party comes in to challenge and rebut with convincing evidence that presumption. This is a complete 180 degrees from where our law is today. Under this bill, Charlie Sheen has immediate physical custody half of the time of his children, and that mother must come in, must get a court date, get on the calendar, and get before the judge to bring evidence that would convince the court that he should not have those children half the time. And until she can get into court and rebut this presumption, that's the way a case like this would work under this bill.
The Senate agreed to the amendment offered by Senator Olson. However, the final vote on the measure was 13-20. Therefore, the bill is lost. It's now time for our legislative spotlight piece. Take a look. Members of the Senate heard from their Senate Majority Leader on an issue that he says will help education deal with funding cuts for this year only. Here is Senator Russ Olson explaining House Bill 1110.
As a result of the Appropriations Committee adopting the revised revenue projections for 2011-2012, so we have 8 months of data in, and the numbers are looking very strong. Right now, the call for 1110 is to take any of the excess revenue that we've had and try to put that back into our K through 12 education system. We've listened to you and heard you very strongly say that if there's excess money, we know you guys have a tough job out there in Pierre. Nobody wants a 10% cut. We've tried to lessen the blow, give that softer landing. There's a lot of little catchphrases that have went around, but either way, I mean, it's a cut. And at the end of the day, it's the fiscally responsible thing to do is to make cuts in state government so that we can get rid of the structural deficit. Those of us that were on board with the 10% cut, as painful as it may be, there were others that said, you know what, and we may even hear from those folks about having a special election for a tax increase to pay for these. To me, House Bill 1110 is going to be the revenue agent that will allow for our schools to have one-time money in a special appropriation, and we would take out the $1 that we had in Senate State Affairs for this House Bill 1110, and we would insert $12,222,096. Now, again, let me remind you, that's one-time money. If you do the math on that, it comes out to $97.01 per student that would go on top of or outside of the ADM.
The measure passed as amended with a 33-1 vote. Next was a bill that has seen numerous changes over the last 2 weeks. Originally, House Bill 1141 would allow the Secretary of State to set deadlines on some specific voting issues. However, it was hoghoused last week by Senator Bob Gray. So the bill now will allow for an initiative process during the next general election. Basically, the bill will allow citizens to come up with their own initiative ideas to the state's budget crisis. If enough signatures are gathered, they can place those initiatives on the November ballot. Well, today, the measure was changed again. Here's the debate.
The process would basically be beginning July 1, they would have about a five-week span in order to collect signatures and put something on the ballot for a November election. I will tell you that this bill, this idea was conceived as a way to allow the people to have a voice in response to some of the big budget decisions that we're making here this year. Virtually everything we do up here, any policy decision we make, and we've seen it in the past with abortion and we've seen it with the smoking ban, the people have a relief valve for all of those things. They're able to refer policy decisions we make. However, they're not able to refer any budget decisions we make. And I, as well as many of you, have heard from the people. They certainly want action. They certainly have some opinions. And frankly, we've heard both sides. There's people who have opinions backing us, and there's certainly a lot of people who want to see something different based on at least our original budget proposal. This bill still does require us to adopt a budget this week and make some decisions, but it also will allow the people of our state, to express their voice this November.
I've been searching for a term over the last couple of minutes of what this actually does. This amendment either unhog houses or de-hog houses or... And somewhere, some learned person will come up with that term so we can use it as fluently as we do the term hog house. This returns the bill back to its original form. I mean the original unamended form that the Secretary of State sent out. And what it basically does, it establishes the dates that absentee ballots will be available and absentee voting can begin. The problems with this began because in the last general election, without malice or without trying to do anything wrong, some counties were having voting at the wrong, too early. And that's because the statute simply says the absentee ballots shall be available 45 days prior to the general election. Well, 45 days prior is a Saturday. So some people were doing it on Friday, some people were waiting until Monday. What this bill does now in its original form simply says absentee ballots will be available 48 days prior to the election and early voting will begin 46 days prior to the election or that Friday. Makes it very simple. It's a necessary piece of legislation, puts it in statute exactly when ballots will be available and when voting can begin or early voting can begin.
The Nelson Amendment passed with a 20-14 vote. The measure is now back in its original form. It then passed out of the Senate with a 27-6 vote. Over in the House of Representatives, education funding took center stage. Senate Bill 200 revises school district fund balances. We'll begin the discussion with an amendment.
Well, this bill removes the caps, as I said. However, in committee, it also dealt with the caps as concerning the sparsity funding formula, and we didn't feel it was proper to remove those caps. That would be the reason we need to bring the amendment in, because the bill actually repeals all of the language having to do with funding or with reserve caps. And it seems a little odd here to remove it on the bill and add it back in the amendment, but that's exactly what we're doing with the addition of the little change in language from balance to equity. Just brings us kind of in compliance with the general accounting standards, but so we need the amendment to actually correct what we did in committee. And basically what this does is restores or keeps the 30% caps on reserve for sparse schools in place. We didn't feel it was proper to add in schools to the sparse formula while we're cutting sparse funding. And so basically, we're removing all the caps from the reserve funds and allowing schools to do what they need to do. It's a local issue. We feel that they should be able to take care of those issues on a local basis. If they're not happy with the amount of money that they're putting aside, then local people can elect new school board members.
This Amendment 200RA is very simple. All that this does is add an emergency clause to this piece of legislation. There are many school districts within our state that will be adversely affected by this savings fund balance cap this year. In this fiscal year, they'll be forced to arbitrarily spend money out of their savings that they wouldn't otherwise be forced to spend. So all that this emergency clause does is allows for this piece of legislation to help them out this year, in this current fiscal year, so that they're not forced to arbitrarily spend that money.
Both amendments passed, and the bill went on to pass out of the House with a 62-6 vote. Representative Dryden begins discussion on Senate Bill 152. It outlines the role of property tax levies for the education funding formula. Here's more.
What Senate Bill 152 seeks to do, the governor's 10% cut applies to state and local. 152 would try to eliminate that property tax reduction and restore part of the cuts. In addition, 152 continues to provide equity between the classes of property for tax purposes. Senate Bill 152 does not increase taxes. It just does not lower them. And it does not affect the Cutler-Gabriel Amendment adjustment. Section 1 resets the ratio between state and local from 56.4 to 53.8. And this is due to revenue being down, especially cigarette tax. I think it's justifiable to lower the state's portion of the per student allocation. And it reduces the governor's cut from 10% to 8.6% with this bill.
What this amendment does is to restore Senate Bill 152 so no cuts are made. Is that what I wanted? No. We are entitled to 1.2 based on the formula that we promised our educators 16 years ago when we passed the formula. It's ridiculous now to sit here in these times to cut our education funding. Let's listen to our constituents. Let's remember that we have to educate. If we don't, we're going to end up going to incarcerate. Let's not add to the unemployment rolls. A 10% cut to education is going to lead to more unemployment out there in our state. We've doubled our unemployment rate, which is not good, and this will not help it.
I guess I would ask, in looking at the amendment, excluding one-time designated reserve funds, what would be the funding source for your amendment?
This is called the general fund, and you know, if this bill passes, then this becomes our priority, and other items will be funded around it. This will be a necessity. It'll come right out of the top of the fund, and you know, then the appropriator is going to have to go to work and start doing some other things.
You know, it's one thing to simply throw out numbers and say we ought to do this and we ought to do that, but when it comes down to it, we need to sign off on a general bill. We have to pay for it. And we know, as we listen to Governor Rounds before he left office and Governor Dugard when he took office, you know, we know the situation we're in, and we know that these numbers are not doable. And we also know that a one-time Band-Aid approach is not going to solve the problem.
Feinstein's proposed amendment fails, but the bill went on to pass with a vote of 47 to 21. It now goes to the governor's desk. If you would like to hear the extended debate on the proposed amendment, as well as the bill or discussion on any of the topics we've covered tonight, just log on to sdpb.org and click on the State House link. And that will conclude today's State House program. Now, for all of us with SDPB, we appreciate your support. Thank you for watching.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.